I don't think this slide needs to have any comment. I use that. I shouldn't use this in this room. Everybody knows that it's a serious disease, that there's a heavy burden on society of this disease. And the prevalence is, it's not an orphan disease, but there's maybe up to 1% of population which suffers from this condition. We looked at a group of extremely disabled patients, like you saw. I saw in total of 23. I had to go to each home separately to see the patients. And we compared the clinical dysfunctions in the totally bedridden patients with a Karnofsky score from 20 to 30, to moderately ill patients with a Karnofsky score of 60-70 in the same country. We compared them with contact controls and non-contact controls. The parameters tested are the classical parameters. Are diseases ruled out? Herpes 6, EBV antibodies, no difference between groups. Borna virus, a few positive patients, but no more than the controls. Herpes 6, EBV, PCR, a few positive patients, but not always correlated with the antibody titers. So we started looking at intestinal dysfunction, and we started looking at LPS. And although you cannot see it very well on this slide, is that in the group that has the very low Karnofsky score, there was a significantly increased level in the plasma of LPS, with a mean of 25 versus 14 in the group with a Karnofsky score more than 60, and 6.4 in the contact controls and 9.7 in the controls. So what we find is that these patients have a higher intestinal permeability. LPS is a strong activator of the immune system. Presence of LPS in the bloodstream suggests a hyperpermeable gut, which is consistent with numerous intestinal symptoms, which we see in most ME patients. Nausea, poor appetite, gastric reflux, abdominal pain, abdominal bowel motility, and bloating. And so the most likely explanation for gut permeability is alteration of the intestinal microbial flora. Together with Henry Butt, University of Melbourne, we looked at the dominant species in the stool, which these patients were examined for, and also in controls. And each group contains more than 100 individuals, both in the controls and in the ME patients. And we saw that for E. coli, there was no difference. But for Enterococcus and Streptococcus, the ME patients have significantly higher numbers that were obtained by culture. For the anaerobic bacteria, there's Bacteroides prevotella, Bifidobacterium and Lactobacillus. And again, the lactic acid formating bacteria, Prevotella, Bifidobacterium and Lactobacillus, are significantly higher in ME patients versus controls. This study is being published in vivo and will be in the next number of that journal. Again, the gram-positive and gram-negative ratio were very significantly altered. The ratio anaerobes-aerobes is different in patients versus controls. It's not different between patients and controls, but the gram-negative versus gram-positive ratio is certainly altered in these patients. This is also from a clinical test, and on this test you can see that there's high numbers of Enterococcus and Streptococcus in these patients, and that other bacteria like Prevotella overgrow in these patients. These Enterococcus counts correlate with symptom expression. They correlate with headache, with arm pain, shoulder pain, myalgia, palpitations, and sleep disturbance. Streptococcus counts correlate with symptom expression of post-exertional fatigue, photophobia, mind going blank, several gland lymphadenia, palpitations also, and dizziness and faintness. So these are all symptoms that we see in the ME patients, and they correlate with abnormalities in streptococcus and enterococcus counts. And when you look at the NMR metabolic profiles of Enterococcus faecalis, you also see that they produce high amounts of lactate. And not only L-lactate, the lactate that we produce, but the bacterial lactate is a D form, it's a D-lactate. And we have, it's this animal lactate, we have more problems breaking down D-lactate than we can break down L-lactate. The lactic acid bacteria correlate with other symptoms like fatigue, photophobia, urinary frequency, urinary urgency, again palpitations, and dizziness and faintness. So a potential toxin produced by this bacteria is hydrogen sulfide. And hydrogen sulfate has important physiological functions. It's produced by the cells and is important gas a signal molecule involved in regulation of blood pressure, neurotransmission, muscle relaxation, and relaxation of regulation of inflammation. It's one of the three gases we have in the body next to CO and NO. But exogenous exposure can be extremely toxic. It's known in industry that 800 ppm exposure kills you. It's a very strong mitochondrial poison. It can directly inhibit enzymes involved in the cell production of energy. Hydrogen sulfide also interferes with oxygen transport by blocking hemoglobin in the red blood cells, and it's a very potent neurotoxin, very similar to cyanide. Enterococcus, streptococcus, and prevotella are very strong hydrogen sulfate producers. A marker was made, produced, associated with HUS production, which can be, in fact, measured with a simple urine test. The maker of the test will explain you now what it's about. So this is Dr. Chris Ruland, PhD.
Well, the test is, I thought it was my motivation because I realized the patient, well, I'm to get myself introduced, I have no track record in ME CFS research. I come from the drug discovery and diagnostic development. And so my motivation to get into this research was because I realized that ME patients, one of the problems there is to get really accepted and have an assay that will actually show there is something wrong with their metabolism. Now, related to the H2S and the other products that come along with H2S, I've been trying to develop this test, and it works as follows. So first of all, the urine is collected, and a part of the a tube that contains a colorimetric reactive is opened. A sample of the urine is taken, is mixed with the colorimetric substrate, and so after 3 minutes, a color is produced. Either it should stay yellow, and then there is no of these metabolites that we find. And so the more the dark the reaction gets from yellow to deep purple gives an indication on the concentration of the metabolites that goes along with the H2S concentration that is found. And also correlates with clinically with the conditions that are known as pre-ME, so where the test scores negative and the reaction fluid stays yellow, with moderate disease where it turns into darker color, and finally to severe disease states where it produces a deep purple color.
Mm-hmm. So I will ask you again for a second in a minute. So patients often present intoxication with mercury, nickel, or other metals. This is an example where after a challenge test with DMPS and zinc DPA, there's a high excretion of copper, mercury, nickel, and silver. We find these things in most patients. In most patients have the same profile. These four metals are excreted in very high concentrations. So we know in the gut that there's mold. I talked to the president of the meeting about this a few minutes ago. But there's streptococci, there are enterococci, and there are fungi. And there's also E. coli present. If these bacteria grow, if they're higher in number, their end products will be, in fact, also increased. And one of their end products is hydrogen sulfide. We know that bacteria protect themselves against certain metals by producing more hydrogen sulfide. If you put bacteria into contact with mercury, for example, the bacterium will defend itself by producing more hydrogen sulfide. And what happens then is that more hydrogen sulfide will be produced, and it's toxic to E. coli that cannot defend itself as well to hydrogen sulfide. But at the same time, the, for example, mercury will become methylated. And methylated mercury is a very toxic substance because it breaks down the gut barrier. And so at the same time, the hydrogen sulfate comes into the bloodstream, and also the methylated mercury will come into the bloodstream.
Of course, and then there is H2S that enters the circulation, then may react with gaseous mediators that are known to control several essential functions, like this, the nitric oxide and carbon oxide radicals. So they have a controlling function, but that may get messed up because of the H2S that comes in. So the other effect of the H2S is it may have a directly effect on the mitochondria by blocking the cytochrome oxidase, and therefore ATP ATP production, which is the energy we use, will go down. The other thing the metals may do, and especially mercury, because it's one of the most famous, is that mercury may react with an enzyme system, a protein system we all have at the cell membrane of our cells, and there it may turn an otherwise normal functional enzyme system or protein system into an aberrant one. As a consequence, it's also this production or the functioning of this aberrant protein will also have a direct effect on the energy production by the mitochondria, and also will have an effect on the ATP production by the mitochondria. Briefly, I will explain what this is all about. So the enzyme system, and so that is at the plasma cell membrane I talked about, is an extracellular system, and is composed of, it shows two enzyme activities. So we all have this enzyme as a constituent of the plasma membrane of our cells, where it controls cell enlargement and also has a biological clock regulatory effect. So the system is composed out of an oxidase and a disulfide thiol interchange enzyme that is connected to the plasma membrane with the Krebs cycle, and so the NADH production or the NADH stock intracellularly. Because the controlling function this enzyme system performs is at the expense of intracellular NADH. So when our metabolism is normal, so the system acts and in a normal way at a normal speed, and molecular oxygen is there the electron acceptor, and so it does not affect the ATP production by the mitochondria. However, as soon as a heavy metal comes in, like for example mercury, that may interact at the level with the copper entity of this enzyme structure, the enzyme structure or that will react in a different way, will produce metabolites in a much faster way, one of which are thiol compounds that may disrupt disulfide bridges that are an essential constituent that make up the structure of elementary proteins. And on the other hand, so the oxidase may turn at a higher speed, and there will be oxygen consumption, and so there will be electron accepting activity by oxygen that will result in the formation of increased concentration of superoxide that may interact with NO radicals, finally to produce peroxynitrite, which is also a common feature that is found with ME patients. So the transformation of the extracellular protein I talked about into an aberrant one may either be have a genetic origin due to a mutation, so may result from an environmental factor like these heavy metals, and in particular mercury, I explained. And thirdly, may also be acquired in the sense that it's a protein that is shed into the circulation, and so that may go from one cell to another cell and finally may affect other persons, so to speak. So then the next question is, how are you going to identify this aberrant protein structure? We can actually do this now by measuring a luminescence response based on the general enzymatic activity of this enzyme structure. And so in normal cases like PFPC, PFPC2, for example, so there's a normal luminescence or normal kinetics of luminescence produced, whereas in an aberrant case, you see that there is an other kinetics and a lower luminescence output. And that allows us to detect and to identify this type of aberrant molecules. So well, this is shortly, this slide shows what's happening. So we have on a normal cell, we have like we have, all have, we have these proteins that control cell enlargement and our biological clock mechanism. So when these come into contact, they may turn into an aberrant form that may go to another cell where it may sit next to an otherwise normal structure of the same protein. And so these proteins, they have the capacity of what is called learn and teaching. So an aberrant protein sit next to another one that is a normal one, the aberrant one may impose its structure on the otherwise normal one to also become an aberrant structure. And so in this way, there may be some multiplication of this aberrant form of protein.
So if we take into account these changes, we have a lot of people that, more than ME patients, that have an abnormal fecal test that have a shift in their bacterial content and have somewhat increased hydrogen sulfate production. They have gastrointestinal symptoms. They have a slower recovery than other people, but may be apparently completely normal and asymptomatic. And In these people, we advise to restore the gut function. And again, the present here is an expert at that. Moderate disease groups, they have an abnormal fecal test. They have, in fact, higher high sulfate metabolites in urine. And exposure to heavy metals plays a role here. Here we see that the fatigue and the other systems, other symptoms, and also gastrointestinal symptoms are present. And the goal there is to restore the gut with probiotics, if necessary with enterocoated antibiotics, and metal chelation. But when you chelate, then you will increase the hydrogen sulfate, so you have to see that you block that. In the severely affected patients, which are not only the bedridden, these tests have been positive in all the bedridden patients, the exposure of heavy metals also has caused aberrant protein conformation. They have strong fatigue, they have multiple symptoms, and their energy levels are extremely low, going to being in fact housebound and bedbound. This is a much more difficult problem because there have been a number of consequences that you can get under control. And so I'm not going to talk about this in detail because we're given only half an hour to present this, but this will be, in fact, the discussion at a conference 2 weeks from now. We know that with these, the disease progressing, that the increasing immune dysregulations, depressed T cell function in K cells, Th17 activation, opportunistic infections, and so on. And so the immune alterations resulting from this intestinal dysfunction, they go over Th1 cells, Th2 cells, and Th17 cells. And in different patients, they're affected differently. So you see all sorts of different things. So if you depress Th1 cells, your protection against intracellular pathogens is down. If you activate Th2, if you depress Th2, your protection against extracellular pathogens is down. And Th17, they protect against fungi and bacteria, mainly in the local immunity mucosa and the skin. So Th1 favors the development of opportunistic viral infections, herpes 6, EBV, parvovirus, B19, enteroviruses, and so on are found in ME patients, and the gastrointestinal mucosa is here the major site of infection. Th2 increase favors the development of allergies, and Th17 increase promotes inflammation, autoimmunity, and blood-brain barrier disruption. And there's also a genetic background plays a role in Th17 upregulation. There are all sorts of polymorphisms in this system, which are associated with ME and with other intestinal diseases. We published about this recently. So the initial patient evaluation is that we do a urine test and we get an idea about the H2S production. We look at intestinal microflora evaluation. We do a challenge test of heavy metals, and we look if there are proteins with abnormal conformation. This is only the case in the very sick patients. We seldom find that in less ill patients. And then assays evaluating the other immune dysfunctions, HV6, EBV, immune dysregulations, and so on, are done. So in conclusion is that gastrointestinal dysfunction play a central role in the pathogenesis of ME. Dysbiosis detrimental effects is mediated by increased production of hydrogen sulfate, and the immune dysfunctions and opportunistic infections arise as a consequence of pre-existing intestinal problems. And to go here to the study of Dieter Buchwald, who looked at twins, the VO2 max of these the healthy twins was also below those of the normal population. So the average VO2 max in her study showed that, in fact, the healthy twin brother or sister also had a lower than expected VO2 max. So it might be that there are already gastrointestinal factors present in the non-ill person, and that, again, this is a person that could, but not necessarily, develop this disease. So once established, infections will contribute to the maintenance and aggravation of disease and also need to be treated. We acknowledge all these studies. Henry Butt at Bio21 Institute, University of Melbourne, and Marion Dix-Lemley, who is an independent researcher who published her hypothesis, chronic fatigue syndrome is caused by dysregulation of hydrogen sulfide metabolism, and that was in fact also published recently. The data of this work will be more extensively in fact discussed at the meeting 2 weeks from now with all the exact numbers and data and p-values, and will be subject also for publications who have been submitted and will be submitted. Thank you.
I feel I must make a few comments because it's very interesting data, as always, Kenny. Firstly, your R values of correlations are very low indeed. 0.17 is almost unacceptably significant, even though the p-value is just less than 0.05. So from a clinical point of view, I think we can ignore all those, and I think you'd agree. Secondly, hydrogen sulfide, Lemley's first paper in Opinions and Trends, suggested it was important. And I have to say, if it was that important, we have all missed a huge number of patients that we could help. Whereas a number of patients with gut problems on a diet that many of us agree on, with a little bit of pharmacotherapy, will improve enormously, suggesting that it's actually not an intractable problem. Thirdly, you mentioned you're going to say some results. So I think as you've got 10 minutes left, you could tell us what your success rate is with probiotics and antibacterials, and B, what was the relevance of the film to begin with?
The relevance of the film to begin with was to show...
To the current data of hydrogen sulfide.
Yeah. So these 23 patients all have an extremely positive test, urine test. It becomes positive within 15 seconds. It colors dark blue in less than 15 seconds. So we consider that as extremely rapid reaction, having a lot of metabolites present. If you see these patients, you know there has to be something toxic. This is not a bacterium, this is not a virus, this is not something from the immune system. There has to be something toxic. You cannot explain this otherwise. The light sensitivity and the noise sensitivity, there is a toxic factor. And I haven't had time to explain the effect on the hypothalamus and so on, but there are much more things that are going on here. Secondly, on the data on the patients that are not so ill, we've got excellent results on and my dietitian is present here with individually tailored diets based on food allergies and based on fructose and lactose breed tests, where we look at, in fact, the digestion of things. And so in those not-so-ill patients, we have, in fact, very good results, and it goes up to 70-80% of people that respond, and within 6 months. Again, there are some patients present in the room, but I don't want them to stand up here. In the patients who have already accumulation of metals more and more, the problem becomes, in fact, more and more difficult, because these metals interfere with normal metabolism. They interfere with a lot of other things. And each time you try to chelate, and there are doctors that are doing nothing else than just chelate patients, When they do it in this type of patients, they usually get a huge negative reaction, and we attribute that to increased production of hydrogen sulfate while you try to chelate when the metals are coming from the interstellar compartment towards the extracellular and you often see that. Same happens in patients that go to the dentist, have their amalgams removed without any form of protection. A lot of patients get their first bout of disease after unprotected removal of these mercury fillings. And this is clearly something we see. So it becomes more and more difficult. But as I say, in the first group, the group one and partially the group two, where you have, in fact, not so big secondary problems, infection, immune dysregulation, it's very easy to get them treated. But once you get more and more secondary problems of immune dysregulation, opportunistic infections, and heavy metal retention, because that's what hydrogen sulfate does, it retains metals in the body, then you get more and more problems, and then it becomes more difficult, and it takes a long time to get patients better. But I have asked to review my practice by an independent group of people, looking at these patients to see what my success rate is, and this will be published by them.
Another question regarding the control group. Did you test other severe ill people which are bedridden?
Because what you describe here for CFS may be just an association which is related to the fact that these people are chronically ill and, of course, have no normal nutrition any longer. So I think this is crucial to have another control group of severely ill patients.
You mean the control group is less sick?
No, more sick. No, a control group which is as severely sick as the CFS patients, but suffering from other diseases.
Oh, from other diseases now. I mean, this is...
Because as long as you do not have such a control group, your conclusions are highly speculative, and you cannot draw conclusions like this based...
Well-controlled
group of other patients who have similar
but that's severe. We're planning to do that in cancer patients and so on. But I mean, you want to find a mechanism that explains the disease so you can treat them. I mean, and has nothing to do with other diseases.
But you're too far. You're two steps ahead. You first of all have to be sure that what you claim is the cause of the disease is really the cause and is not just an association. Caused by other things like that these people have, of course, severely disturbed gut function and severely diminished nutritional uptake. And, for example, increased LPS in the gut, you find increased LPS concentrations in the blood, you find as well in other severely ill patients frequently.
Mm-hmm. I don't know what kind of disease you talk about, because this is some of the worst diseases there is. That means these people are not sick, you mean? What you compare these with cancer patients, or what other disease you compare that with in the same state that cannot move their arms and legs and so on? That's, I mean, there are very few patients like that.
Well, people with diminished Karnofsky.
Just one sec. The point is a very valid one. If you get bedbound patients whose nutrition and bowels are not normal. Mm-hmm. What is the control data of this sort of patient? This is what you're saying.
Yes.
With your ME patients that are in bed. So a sick control group is absolutely mandatory to show the specific relevance.
Well, you will have to take a group, for example, that has cancer at advanced stage and has been bedridden for a while, but I don't see any other group that you can compare with these people. Yeah, strokes, yeah. You can compare that with, yeah.
Patients with severe heart disease. That's
a possible control group, and we'll do that, yeah.
Tests for urine stool, are they available in the UK? If so, if anybody can contact you.
The urine test is very simple, self-testing test, and the stool test is only available at two places, one in Europe and one in Australia. It's still culture. It's still very lot of handwork. In about 6 months to a year, there will be these bacteria. We need to know. We need to put this into PCR tests because that will be much simpler to do. Now all these bacteria need to be cultured. And also, the taking of the stool sample is extremely delicate. It has to be in a completely airtight bag. So people have to do this right. And some of the samples cannot be used because if the transport is too long or, in fact, it's not completely sealed off from air, some bacteria will die and you don't get viable cultures. So it's still a problem thing to do, but it's done daily. 6 to 8 of these things, of these cultures, are made, and it's for me a very good tool to see what's happening.
Of spontaneous major improvement, I was bedbound. I was in a similar state to that person for 2 years, almost as bad as that. I didn't have any particular dietary. I had very little intervention, actually, apart from nimodipine, after which I improved. But I'm now able to kind of work a little bit and such. I've still got the same amalgams in my teeth. I resisted getting those reduced because of the complications. What's happened to? What would you predict has happened to my physiology to allow? You know what I mean? To allow a so spontaneous kind of resolution of the heavy metal problem.
That's an individual question, and I cannot answer that because you have to have data to that, and it would be only be speculation. But the most of these patients, they don't get better spontaneously. I mean, they're just lying there, and some of them in Belgium, I know of some of them, they just do an aspiration pneumonia and they die.
Thank you. I think the message here is that the data with hydrogen sulfide and the theory behind it is interesting. And until critical control groups are done and patients like yourself are studied in more detail and the statistics are perhaps firmed up so that one doesn't look at the p-value but one looks at the r-value, I think we'll have another talk in 6 months and hear some more data. Kenny, thank you.